Hello and thank you for joining us. We are live here with the brand new iPad mini. I'm Richard.
And I'm Andy.
And thanks again for joining us to take a look at Apple's new device. We're also going to compare it to some of its main competitors. And for any questions you might have, you'll see just in the comments box underneath this video, you can write right into us and we'll try and answer as many questions as we can get through. So please do keep on writing in as we go over the new features of the iPad mini and all of its main rivals. So Andy, you've had a bit more time with this than I've had a chance to. What are your first impressions? What do you think of this?
First impressions are generally really positive. I mean, it is typical of Apple. It's very, very well made. The design is very nice. And the most notable thing is just how much lighter it is compared to a full-size iPad. So the iPad mini weighs around precisely 308 grams, and the main iPads generally weigh around 650 or slightly more.
So this is about half the weight then?
Yeah, definitely, and you really notice the difference.
Okay, so if I hold up one of the main-sized iPads here and just put it next to it, you can see there is a big, big difference in the size, and it's certainly lighter to hold, but what's it like to actually work with on a screen that much smaller?
So that was my main concern. I mean, obviously, you're going to be using the keyboard, for example, quite a lot. And I was concerned that on the smaller screen that would be more difficult to use. Now, it's certainly slightly more difficult, just naturally the keys are slightly smaller, but it is still very usable. So, for example, if I go into the Notes app and bring up the keyboard, when you're using the keyboard in portrait mode, like this, for example, it's actually really comfortable to use it. Holding it two-handed but just typing with your thumbs, and it actually works really, really well. You can build up quite a decent speed, which makes it quite comfortable for writing emails.
The size of the screen it is, as well as sort of typing at it the way you could with a keyboard in front of you can kind of approach it with two thumbs at once. I mean, Apple did once famously say, I think it was Steve Jobs himself, said it would never go into the market of tablets of this size. Yeah. It was 10-inch or nothing.
Yes, I think the precise words he used is that the 7-inch tablets were dead on arrival, which is typically theatric.
Yeah, a little theatric, but Apple didn't get to be there first.
No.
I mean, there's a whole range of rivals here. I've got the Amazon Kindle HD in my hands here, which is about the same size. Has a lovely advert for Titanic on it. One of the downsides to the Kindle HD we found is every time you turn on its lock screen, it gives you an advert for one of its products. So let's just cycle through a couple. There's Titanic. What else can they offer me today? And there's The Dark Knight Rises, and the next one up, No Rules Handbook for Writers. So pushing a product to me every time I turn it on, something I guess you're not going to get with this one.
No, I mean, that's a feature that Amazon's pushed quite heavily, and you can actually turn off those adverts on the Amazon tablet by paying £10 extra when you buy the tablet. So it's not something you have to put up with. And it's relatively intrusive because it only appears on the lock screen. You can kind of ignore them. But I think this is an interesting difference between, say, Amazon's approach and Apple's and also Google's, is that the Kindle Fire tablet is really all about selling stuff. So it's very, very cheap. It's cheaper even than the Google Nexus 7. So let's run through the prices, actually. So the iPad mini I've got in my hands here is 16GB Wi-Fi version, is £269.
£269 for that's the basic version, the cheapest version of that you can get.
Yeah. Okay. The Google Nexus 7 has a different various range of prices. The 8GB version, this is it, Richard's hands.
So about similar size there on the Google Nexus
7.
Yeah,
yeah. So it costs £159 for the 8GB version. There's also a 32GB version arriving soon, which will be around £200. And then the Kindle Fire HD is around £150, £160.
So in short, I mean, the Kindle Fire HD, the Google Nexus 7, these are all significantly cheaper than the Apple alternatives. So what does this device do that should make me want to part with more money?
Well, I mean, obviously Apple has the advantage that it's had the iPad around for quite a long time, and that means it has a really, really big app store with lots of very good quality apps. And I think that's the key advantage that Apple has over its competitors. Google is catching up with its Google Play Store, is certainly improving. However, Amazon Store, they've only been doing tablets for a short amount of time, and it has its own app store that's completely separate to the Google one, despite the fact that it actually runs Android. So there aren't as many apps on that compared to even the Google Play Store.
So if I pick up here's the Kindle HD again here. I mean, it's very familiar as an Amazon experience, really, isn't it? You say it runs the Google operating system, but there's no real trace of Google anywhere on it.
No.
They've kind of scrubbed all of that off, and it's just Amazon everywhere you look. So, I've got the bookstore here, and there's no two ways about it. This is a product to enable me to buy more content, isn't it? That's what Amazon wants you to do with this. I mean, I can go back to the home screen, and yes, there are apps and things I can cycle through, but it looks very different to a home screen on most Android or iOS tablets.
Yeah, of course, that's Amazon's approach, but that isn't to say, of course, that Google and Apple don't want to sell stuff to you as well. So Amazon has its own, sorry, Google, Apple has its own iBooks app, for example. And you can buy books from their store. And of course, they've got iTunes store. You can buy music and films and pretty much everything else. I mean, the main difference is simply that Amazon puts all that stuff really up front as part of the experience.
Long term, you know, for Google with Android or Amazon with its Amazon stores or Apple, what they want is you buying more content over time and getting locked into sort of the family of, you know, maybe this is your first ever Apple device, but after a few years of using this and you've downloaded a lot of apps, your next device is probably going to be Apple as well, isn't it? I think for me, Andy, I mean, that's why it surprises me that this is so much more expensive than its rivals. I mean, is it the sort of, you know, reassuringly expensive? It lets you know that it's got that Apple veneer that, you know, tells you it's a premium product. Yeah. Is it worth paying that extra money? I mean, does it feel like a better quality screen, for example?
So, ultimately, it's very much a personal choice. I mean, I think in terms of the build quality and design, the iPad Mini does feel like a more expensive tablet. It does feel like you're paying for more. You're not, you know, you're getting more with your money. In terms of the screen question, that's quite an interesting one, because one of the things about the iPad Mini is it's got the same resolution screen as, say, the iPad 2. It doesn't have a Retina display like on the most recent iPad 3 and iPad 4.
Now, the Retina display, and they've got that on the iPhone as well, that's sort of the what Apple touts as about, you know, as high a resolution as you'll ever need. Your eye can't apparently you know, even perceive a better resolution than that. This doesn't have that?
No, this doesn't have that, mainly for cost reasons. If it did have a Retina display, it'd be even more expensive, and then it would just be silly. But the interesting thing is it actually has a lower resolution screen than its rivals. So both the Nexus 7 and the Kindle Fire HD have 1280 by 800 resolution screens on smaller physical screens. So this has a 7.9 inch screen, and both of these two have 7 inch screens.
So these effectively have, let me get this right, more pixels going across a smaller area. So they should be more densely detailed than the Apple one.
The technical term is pixels per inch, and you get that kind of number gets flown around quite a lot these days. And certainly the Nexus 7 and the Fire HD have an advantage in that front. Of course, that's not all there is about picture quality on tablets, and we'll be getting all of these into the lab soon. In fact, we've already had the Kindle Fire HD in the lab to test them properly. You know, there's things like viewing angles, the brightness of the screen, the colours, you know, colour saturation, the colour quality and accuracy, lots of little things that make up the quality of the screen. I don't think ultimately that people are going to be disappointed with the sharpness of the screen on the iPad Mini, unless, for example, you've got an iPad 3 or iPad 4 and you're used to that super high resolution sharp screen. Then you might think this looks a little bit
blurry. You might feel like you're trading down a bit.
Yes, a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Well, look, if you find me looking at my phone, I'm not losing interest in you, but we're getting some questions through. So thank you very much for all the people sending questions in. If you do have more questions about, for example, the screen quality we were just talking about, please do keep firing them in. So, Andy, one of the questions we've had through from John Long here. How do the stores for the iPads, the Nexus and the Kindle Fire compare? Mm-hmm. Now, John tells us he's tempted to stay with Apple purely because of iTunes. Mm-hmm. And I can kind of understand that. If you've previously owned an Apple product, which it seems like John has, say, you know, an iPod or an iPhone, would you not naturally stick with Apple products and get an iPad Mini or a full-size iPad rather than an Amazon or an Apple? But yeah, what are the Amazon and Apple stores like? In comparison to one another.
Okay, so the Google store is certainly larger and more populous than the Amazon store, simply because Google's been around a bit longer. And although the Google Play Store doesn't have quite as many tablet apps as, say, the Apple App Store, it's certainly improving, particularly now that the Google Nexus 7 has been out for a few months. It's done really well, it's sold very well, and that means more developers are keen to develop apps for that platform because they expect to make money from selling them. Amazon's a little bit further behind on that front because Amazon has its own store. It's certainly improving, but of the three app stores, it's certainly the smallest.
So, I mean, this is the Amazon App Store I'm bringing up here just now, and it's just populating a bit now, but I imagine you can see games and sort of the popular things which you'd expect. I'm sure you'll be able to track down Angry Birds in here somewhere, I mean, a lot of people probably consider an App Store to look like Apple's. It's kind of the standard that's been set. But, Amazon's selling content as well, really, aren't they? I mean, they want you downloading videos, they want you downloading books and such. So I imagine if you did go out and get the Amazon Kindle Fire HD, you know, you wouldn't feel like, oh, I'm not going to be able to get all the latest music or the latest films or anything like that. They'll all be downloadable, won't they? It'll just take time for the other apps to percolate through.
Yes, I think the interesting thing, of course, as well, the Amazon one, although it's based on Android, you don't get all the Google apps, so it doesn't have the Gmail app and all the Google, other Google apps, because it's not an official Android device. Amazon's kind of taken Android and done what it wants it with it. And that doesn't mean you can't access email and stuff like that. There are separate apps for that. You're just not getting the Google experience, which is one of the reasons why a lot of people buy Android tablets, because they like using Google's online products such as Google Drive, Gmail, and so on and forth.
Okay. We got a question here from Bugle, who's asking us, some apps are simply stretched when they're designed for one screen and then made available on another. And I think that's something that's quite common with Android products, you know, which were made for an Android phone and then they're just stretched to an Android tablet. Do you think that any apps will be designed especially for the Mini? That's an interesting question there, because you could end up with sort of three tiers of Apple products, something for the phone size, something for the full size, and something for this size. Do you think that's likely?
Well, no, actually. One of the reasons, I mean, it's quite interesting, is that the screen size on the iPad Mini is 7.9 inches. So it's actually quite a bit bigger than say, the Amazon Kindle Fire, for example, has a 7-inch screen. The actual physical dimensions aren't that much different, so the iPad Mini is slightly taller and maybe a slightly bit wider, but fundamentally it's got a larger screen in quite a small area. And the reason they've done that, so says Apple, is because this is just, it's about as small as you can get on an iPad, where the apps that are designed for the larger iPads are still just as usable. And so far, I've only tried a smattering of apps, but so far that seems to have borne itself out. I've had absolutely no problem using all the apps that are designed for the larger iPads on this. So it is designed in such a way that you can use exactly the same apps on the iPad Mini and the larger iPads.
And I suppose Apple probably wouldn't want developers to go about developing apps specifically for this screen size, which then wouldn't be suited to the 10-inch tablet
exactly,
as well.
Yeah,
okay. Well, so we got another question here through from Mikey, which is, how does it feel to navigate around the iOS 6, which is the operating system used on this? Has Apple basically just shrunk everything down from the larger tablet? Does the size make it easier to navigate or harder to navigate?
There isn't a great deal of difference. Apple has basically shrunk everything down to make it fit. That's exactly what they've done.
So there's, the two home screens that you can see there.
Yeah.
And it does look pretty similar from one
to the other. Yeah, and it is exactly the same. It's just a bit smaller. It works just fine. I've tried a bit of typing on the keyboard, which works absolutely fine. It's slightly less roomy, but still perfectly usable.
Now, typing's a bit I'd be interested in, because, I mean, I have learned to get used to typing on a touchscreen.
Yeah.
Now, if you've got sort of the full-size iPad, it's quite a generous large keyboard.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, it doesn't have to be an iPad, any 10-inch tablet. Yeah. But when you're suddenly shrinking down to the 7.9-inch screen, what's it like actually typing away on that? Do you find your fingers getting cramped in? Or?
I haven't typed for a very long time, so I wouldn't know about cramping and stuff like that. What I would say, it's very comfortable to type in a portrait mode, because you can just sit there with your thumbs like this, basically.
Oh, okay, so as well as typing away on a normal keyboard.
And, of course, you can go into the portrait mode like this, and I've tried typing in this mode, and it works okay. It's not quite as good as on the larger iPads, but it works perfectly well. And provided you're not writing really long documents, you're just writing emails and the occasional comment on a website or something like that, it's absolutely fine.
Okay. Well, we've got some more questions coming through. This is from the anonymously named guest. In use, does the fourth generation iPad seem twice as fast as the third generation iPad, which is one of the boasts that Apple made? Will a normal user notice the difference in everyday use for email, internet browsing, etc.? Well, I think that's a good question. I mean, be it Apple or any manufacturer, they're always very quick to come out with claims whenever a new product comes out. For the fourth generation iPad, they're claiming twice as fast as the third generation, which only came out 7 months ago. There's probably a few people feeling a bit bruised that they went and bought one earlier this year. So, I mean, have we noticed that it's that much faster?
Difficult to quantify, really. I mean, the iPad 3 was no slouch.
It was no slouch, was it?
No, exactly. No. The main thing you'll notice probably is better graphics in games, for example. You certainly will notice that web pages load a little bit faster, and you won't experience really any delays loading apps and things like that. But we haven't got it into the lab yet, and it went on sale today. So it's been shuffled off to the lab as we speak, basically.
So we'll hope to have the Witch test results soon to tell us just how much
faster
it is.
Yes, hopefully by the end of next week, we should hope.
Okay, well, I mean, talking about sort of the processor speed and such, the iPad Mini that you've got, that's not as fast as the fourth generation iPad, is it? I mean, it's shrunk down, so maybe there's less room in it, but this has got the same specs as the older iPad 2, is that right?
Yes, in broad strokes, yes. So it's got the same processor as the iPad 2. It's got a few differences. So it's got a higher quality HD camera on the front, and the camera on the back is also a better quality one. It's the same camera as in the iPad 4, so the cameras are better. But the actual processor inside is the same as the iPad 2. And that's actually sort of two, possibly three generations behind the iPad 4 in terms of processor speed. So that doesn't mean it's slow. I mean, you know, when you're flicking around, it's opening apps and using the basic apps, it's very, very fast. It's perfectly comfortable. Where you'll notice the difference is that if you're playing games, you don't get the highest quality graphics as you can on the more expensive iPads.
Okay, well, so we've got a few more questions coming through. Someone's asked us, is the Wi-Fi faster on the iPad 4 than on the iPad 2 or 3? And I imagine that's something we're just going to have to wait for our test labs to be able to tell us.
Yeah, so Apple claimed, again, that the Wi-Fi on the iPad 4 is twice as fast because they've added some new technology. It's slightly complicated. It's all about bonded channels. I won't go into the details of that, but we'll certainly be testing that in the lab to see exactly how much of a difference that makes.
Okay, we've got a question through from Jane9 here. Now, this is one I'd really like to hear the answer to, if possible. For £70 more than the Nexus, this is the Google Nexus I'm holding here, what do you actually get and is it worth the price difference? Now, I think that's what it all comes down to because actually Google's Nexus 7 tablet got to the market a great deal sooner than this one did. And I think it was a bit of a shock to all of us because actually this is a good quality tablet that begins selling at, what, £159?
It's £159 for the 8GB version.
And for a 16GB that's equivalent to this, it's £199.
Yeah, and they're actually bringing out a 32GB version, which is going to be about the same price as well. So you get a lot for your money, the Google Nexus 7. I'm a big fan, if I just get this out, I mean, I'm a big fan of the Nexus 7. It's a great price for a tablet. It's a very nice size, very comfortable. And in comparison, it's only slightly more expensive than the Kindle Fire HD, but I personally feel the build quality is in a completely different league. It just feels a lot tighter and nicely made. And what I particularly like, it's got this rubberized back, which is just really nice to hold. It's particularly nice when you're also just reading books or something like that. It's very comfortable. In terms of answering the exact question, is what do you get more from the iPad? I mean, the iPad is a step above this, even when it comes to just build quality and refinement. It does feel nicer.
And it is very, very thin. It's surprisingly light.
Yes, and you know, ultimately, that sounds superficial. But you know, if you're spending a lot of money on a product, and it's still £200, it's still a lot of money. Mm. You know, those are the kind of things you're going to start thinking about in terms of what you get more of. I mean, it does come back down to the sort of app situation. Apple's App Store, when it comes to tablet apps, has definitely got more choice and variety and depth to it at the moment compared to Google's. Google's is no doubt going to improve, and Google's got some really cool features on the Nexus 7 which set it apart from the iPad, particularly the superior Maps on the Nexus 7, which we talked about a lot recently.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm opening up the App Store here, which is just going a little slow with the Wi-Fi we've got in the room right now, but you know, the Apple App Store is what this is famous for, but the Google Play Store is growing, growing, growing. Yeah. And I mean, I think if you did go out there and buy a Google tablet tomorrow, including this, you know, very cheaply priced Nexus, you're not going to feel too hard done by. You probably are going to be able to get most of the apps you want.
I think ultimately, if you're already an iPad owner or perhaps an iPhone owner and you have a preference for Apple products, I think I'd still recommend you go for the iPad mini simply because you've got some familiarity. It's very similar to all the other products you've got. However, if you're an Android user, don't feel like you have to move to Apple because it's so much better, because actually the Google tablets available are improving so quickly.
And you'll be saving a bit of money along the way as well.
And you'll be saving a bit of money.
Which never hurts. So we got a question here from someone called Apple Wind, who is saying, I keep hearing a lot about Retina displays and how the iPad mini doesn't have one. What exactly is a Retina display and should it influence which tablet I buy? So we touched on this earlier. Now, Retina displays, as I understand it, they're the ones which you can get on the iPad 4th generation.
Yep.
You could get it on the 3rd generation. Yep. You can also get it on the iPhone 5.
Yes, and in fact, Google's just announced a new 10-inch tablet called the Nexus 10, which also has a Retina display.
So, okay, and they're calling it a Retina display, or just something to compete with Apple?
I can't recall what they've called it, but at the end of the day, what a Retina display means is that the resolution is so high and that the screen is so sharp that even if you go quite close into the screen, you cannot really discern the pixels.
Oh, so you can't actually make out the granular detail of it.
Basically, fundamentally, it just makes the screen look really, really sharp. If you never had, I mean, I think the interesting thing is that people who have owned an iPad, for example, a Retina display, look at the iPad mini and go, oh, the screen's a bit blurry. But if you've never really experienced that and you don't care so much about that, tablets that don't have Retina displays doesn't make them bad.
No, no.
It just means they're just not quite as sharp.
But if you've used an iPhone, I mean, it's the iPhone 4, 4S and 5, which have Retina displays, would you then look at this and think, well, hang on, I've seen better than that?
Yes, I suppose so. And I've got an iPad 2, personally. I haven't got a Retina iPad, and I've got an iPhone 5, which has a Retina screen. And you do notice the difference. But you kind of get over it because you know what, it's not a really big deal. No. It's certainly a nice to have, but it's not a must have in my
book.
Okay,
so you can certainly live without it. So a question here from Mary H. Do you think that there is value in owning both an iPad and an iPad mini? And if the iPad mini is for travelling, when you're on the train, etc., mm-hmm. what's the iPad for? Now, I think this is a great question because really, I mean, let's say you already own a product this size. You already own a 10-inch tablet and call it an iPad for argument's sake. Would I then think, well, you know what, I'm going to go out and buy one of these as well? Is there a place in your life, assuming you've got the budget, to have two of these? Is there any point
having two of these? I don't think so at all, no. I mean, ultimately, I'm just going to put these together so you can see the size difference. I don't think there is a case.
See, it's quite a bit. Yeah. Quite a bit larger. And they're very different products in the way that
they
you
are very
them.
Different products. But if you're going to own a tablet, own one tablet, I think is the moral of the story. You're better off owning, say, a laptop and a tablet than you are two tablets, because although the size difference has some impact in terms of how easy it is to, say, just do kind of productivity like writing emails and creating documents and things like that, ultimately they do the same thing. Okay, so I don't think there's a real benefit.
Let's put it in terms of who you are and what you already own. If you already own a 10-inch tablet, could you possibly be looking at this a bit enviously and thinking, well, that's a bit smaller, that's a bit neater, I could carry that around. Would you consider trading in, maybe selling your second-hand and moving down the size category?
Well, as an iPad 2 owner, I can say I'm rather tempted to do exactly that.
And that's the things like, just commuting, you can hold it in one hand.
So, if I'm sitting here now, you can see, I can hold this really comfortable one-handed. I can read a book and use it like this really, really comfortably. When I've got an iPad 2 or any larger
iPad.
One
of the full-size ones?
Yeah, it's a little bit too large. You're not quite sure how to hold it. And if you hold it up for a long time, your arm gets tired. So it does depend a little bit on how you use it. But I'm certainly personally tempted to the iPad Mini because I do like the small
screen. And you say that as an existing owner. Now, how about someone who's never owned a tablet before? Mm-hmm. And let's say, just put yourself in frame of mind, you're someone, you don't own a tablet, you never have. I'm about to give you £400 and I would like the change back, but you go down the store and you're going to buy a tablet today. What would make you buy a small one rather than a big one? Will you be missing out on something if you don't go for the large screen? Will you be missing out on something if you don't go for the small screen?
I would personally go for the smaller tablets simply because the more you carry something around with you, the more you get out of it. I mean, I take smartphones as a perfect example. The reason smartphones have become so popular is because it's the one device that you carry around with you all the time, and that makes it really, really useful. Because it does so many different things, that just makes it all the better. And I think when you've got something smaller like this, it is just more comfortable to use. And I've said about reading a lot so far, but For reading, the smaller tablets are so much better.
Just because you can hold it.
Because you can hold it comfortably.
Well, I mean, here's a question. So let's say I'm a smartphone owner, iPhone or an Android phone, whatever it is. I could see the argument in owning a smartphone and then going out and getting a 10-inch tablet as well, which I nearly dropped, getting a 10-inch tablet. I mean, look at the difference in the product I'm buying. If I already own this smartphone, what's going to make me go out and buy one of these as well? I mean, it's not that much bigger. My hand's in the way of most of that. But it's about three times the size? Once, three times.
Yeah.
Do I need both those products? Because I can already carry this around with me. I can already take this on the train. I can read books if I want. I can read the newspaper. I can play games on it. Two portable products instead of one.
No, I think that's a really excellent point. And actually, one of the things I've been thinking about is, for example, if I go out and buy a tablet, do I decide not to upgrade to the latest phone? And I think that would be a really interesting thing, whether we see people actually deciding to buy a small tablet and not then upgrading their phones and being happy with, say, having the iPhone 4 or 4S instead of the iPhone 5, or using an older Android phone instead of upgrading to the latest and greatest Android phone. So I think that's an interesting point. I mean, from a personal experience point of view, when I first got a tablet, I stopped using my smartphone as much as I did before. I still use my smartphone a lot. It's very useful when I'm walking around town trying to find my way about, provided I'm not using Apple's Maps, of course. there are lots of occasions where I don't want to carry my tablet around, if I'm going on a night out, I'm not going to sit around with my iPad out all day. You're totally right. They do very similar things. I think the larger screen is better for lots of things, particularly reading, but also playing games. It's really good. I really like this size for playing games, particularly because of the weight as well. But that's really a personal decision to make. It depends on how much you're willing to invest in the technology you use, how important that is to you. So
okay, so it could be a bit of a luxury buy if you're already a smartphone, but, you know, a smartphone owner. But yeah, I'm sure you'd enjoy it. So some more questions coming in. Going back to sort of the nuts and bolts of what's inside these things. How good is the camera on the iPad Mini? I think you mentioned earlier it's a step up from what was on the iPad 2. Mm-hmm. Now, is that the same camera that you can get on the fourth generation iPad as well?
Yes. So the front-facing camera is the same. It's an HD camera, which is a noticeable upgrade. So a lot of the previous iPhones and iPads until the third generation iPad and the iPhone 5 had VGA resolution front-facing cameras.
And which you use for video calls.
Yeah, which you use for video calls and maybe the occasional self-portrait or something like that. But the HD camera, it's a lot better. It just looks much nicer. You really notice a difference straight away. The camera on the back is also better. If you're comparing this to the iPad 2, as I mentioned earlier, the cameras on this one are much better. So this has got a 5 megapixel camera on this, and it's the latest version of that camera. It's also on the latest iPhones. It doesn't have a flash, which is a slight tricky thing, but honestly, your tablets aren't really about taking photos.
These two tablets we've got here, so the Google Nexus and the Kindle, no cameras at all on the back, are there?
No.
Cameras on the front for video calls, but you can't use these like you would a digital camera just to take a photo.
And to be honest, I mean, that's fine. I've owned an iPad.
It's not the most convenient thing for taking pictures.
I've owned an iPad for 2 years, and I've yet to take a photo on the rear-facing camera, so I think that says everything about how much you need one.
Yeah, okay, well, it's good to have an upgrade to a camera, but I think, like you say, that's not its prime function, first and foremost. So we've got a question here from Bugle again, who has asked, do you think the iPad Mini will become the most popular form factor, and did Apple get it wrong with the 9.7-inch screen all along? That's a good question.
This debate could run and run.
Couldn't it? I mean, Apple, you could say, have conceivably run the risk of eating into the sales of the 9.7-inch tablet. If this thing really takes off. And we picked up one of these today that's just gone on sale. And there was a queue at the Apple store.
I've heard conflicting reports. I know that apparently the one on Regent Street didn't have a queue, but the one at Covent Garden did, at least that's what I've heard. So, but it's certainly not like the iPhone. People aren't sort of running out and queuing forever to get one. So it's not as big a launch as that. I mean, as to whether Apple missed a trick, I don't really know. I mean, ultimately, they sold 100 million iPads, so they haven't done too badly.
No, they're not suffering.
They've all got nice stock options, and they've done very nicely for themselves. But whether they missed out, I don't know. I think there's still a place for the 10-inch tablets. I think what would be interesting to see is whether Apple is a bit more innovative in future to make the 10-inch tablet more productive, for example.
Yeah, is there going to have to be something that they do to make you think twice about a 10-inch thing? Actually, you know, there is plenty I can do with that. Maybe it will be looking at keyboard compatibility. Yeah. I mean, the way Microsoft's done with the Surface Tablet's keyboard. Mm-hmm. And when I saw that approach of using a cover as a keyboard, I kind of thought, you know, I'd expect that from Apple, actually. That looks
so cool. I think it's a very clever feature, and I think that's something Apple, if we're being truthful, and being totally truthful, the fact that Apple has launched this is an admission that actually other companies were right to launch smaller tablets.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, they had to follow Kindle and Google.
Yeah.
And Apple, they don't like being a follower. I mean, they're meant to be the ones setting the standard for this market, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, you know, they can't be in the lead all the time. I think it's great for consumers, actually, because, I mean, there's so much choice now. You know, I think it's a brilliant, and I said this last time when we were talking about the iPhone, there's so much choice of really good smartphones, and it's now the same with tablets. So it was quite a long time when the iPad first came along where, frankly, the competition was a bit pants.
Yeah.
But now, if you're going out to buy a tablet, the choices are many, and there's lots of really good options.
No, you're absolutely right. Okay, so I think, let me see, we've got, a few more questions coming in. One's from SwiftBod. Do we have anything to say about accessories, especially the impact of the new Lightning connector? Now, that's a good question that we haven't got around to yet. Could you just show the connector at the bottom
so
of that?
So that's the connector on the iPad Mini.
So that is different to, we've got an iPad 2 here, which has that traditional 30-pin connector. So if you've been buying Apple products for the last sort of, 5 years or so? Longer?
Wow, longer probably.
Longer. Yeah, so going back to some of the iPod
original
ranges.
Original iPod, really. Yeah, the original. Well, not quite the original, but certainly the...
Some of the earliest iPod ranges used this 30-inch connector. Yeah. Now, you could be a very, very loyal Apple buyer, for example, who's been buying things from the earliest iPod range onwards. You've been buying connector docks and, you know, these speaker docks you can plug them into, which use that connector point. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, what's this?
Well, I mean, I think there's two ways to look at this, really. I mean, it is certainly an inconvenience that you know, if you've got existing accessories, you're going to have to buy an adapter. The adapter costs £25 as well, so it's not a cheap investment. However, I do have a smidgen of sympathy for Apple, because one of the reasons that they've created the smaller connector is that it means you can make products as thin and light as this.
I mean, it's a much smaller connection point, but I don't know, like £25?
Oh, no, I totally agree. The adapter, the cost of the adapter is ridiculous.
I've seen it. It's a little piece of white plastic, which very quickly ruins the look of every single speaker dock you attach it to. Let's say you've got some nice chrome-plated speaker dock or a nice dark black one, and then you put this little cheap-looking bit of plastic, cheap-looking but not cheap costume, and all of a sudden it looks terrible, but you're stuck with it, really. Or either that or you go out and buy a whole new speaker dock.
We've gone over this quite a lot in the past, and it is a major inconvenience for people that have bought them. I wish I could provide more advice and solace, but unfortunately we are stuck in this situation.
Apple probably aren't, you know, lying awake at night feeling guilty about that. I mean, their sales are probably going to keep on going well on this.
Yes. As I say, it's one of life's annoying little things. It's not something, it's actually something that's been going on for years, and it's one of my bugbears, actually, is that generally with technology, every time we buy a new thing, we get a new charger, and it does seem a bit ridiculous. We kind of collect all these things. It's so wasteful. But unfortunately, that's reality of the things. What I would say, in mitigation, as I say, is it is smaller, and also one of the nice things, it is a very nice connector, so it's actually reversible, it's slightly easier to use and stuff like that.
Some conveniences.
So there are some conveniences, but ultimately, if you've got existing accessories, it is a bit of a pain.
Okay, so we've got a question from one of the new competitors to the iPads in general, which is the Windows RT tablet. Mm-hmm. So the Windows RT tablet is out, says KK, and the Windows RT tablet has a keyboard. Mm-hmm. Now, this doesn't have a keyboard as a separate thing which you can plug onto it at this point in time. Anyway, how fiddly is it to type on the iPad mini? And the second question, is the RT basically a netbook that can be folded up? I think we should come to that one second, but first let's just touch on the typing on the iPad mini. You mentioned this before, that one of the things you liked is being able to attack it with two thumbs, really. I'm a typer. I do a lot of writing. This is something that's always held me back from getting a tablet, because I kind of need a physical keyboard. This is why I'm still very loyal to my sort of 7-year-old laptop, which is giving up the ghost every single day. But if you had to regularly type on this, what do you reckon?
This is not a product for doing serious work on.
You wouldn't want to write your memoirs on this.
No, you wouldn't write your memoirs on it. It's absolutely fine for writing emails and the occasional editing documents and stuff like that. And if you're in a meeting, for example, and typing notes, I've tried it, it's okay. But it's not a serious thing for typing on. It's not quite as easy. And actually, if we get the other iPad out, and we can just compare the size of the keyboards. Bear with me a moment while I find the right app. If we just get this out, can you, do you mind holding that?
Yeah,
so if I get the same thing out, we can just see the difference in size of the keyboards there.
And I've turned it side on.
Yeah, let's do that. So you can see the difference there. There is a notable difference in the size of the keys. So that's a fundamental what it looks like. So if I put my finger on that, that's what it looks like. And then if I put my finger on there, you can see just a slight, there is a notable difference in size. It doesn't make this impossible to type on, it's still usable, but if you actually really do use an iPad for typing a lot on, then you probably want to think twice about getting the mini.
Okay, all right, that's an interesting way of looking at it. And the second question from KK, is the Windows RT tablet basically a netbook that can be folded up? I quite like that. What do you think?
I've tried one. I guess that's true to an extent. I think one of the interesting things about the Surface RT, or the Surface with Windows RT, to give it its full name, is it's actually really quite large. It's got a 10.6-inch screen, so that's even larger than the iPad. And it's also it's widescreen. So it's very much more like a laptop in that respect. I think that it does have a kind of slightly netbooky feel to it. I mean, it's obviously slightly more expensive than netbooks.
And then you've got to buy that keyboard as an additional extra. Yeah, it doesn't come with, because there's two keyboard options, aren't there?
Yes, so it's $399 without any keyboard. The soft touch keyboard, which is kind of like, it's almost like a touch sensitive keyboard, is £99, £100. Mm-hmm. And then the touch type cover, the type cover, is £109.
And that's a bit more like a conventional keyboard. Yeah, that's going very thin, but you do get pushback from the keys, don't you?
And they are designed, the Windows tablets are far more orientated around also, reading and using the internet, stuff like that, but also doing proper work. So they all come pre-installed with Microsoft Office, for example. And that means if you've got Word documents you want to edit, you can pretty much use them as you would
and
on your
type
on your
away
PC
on
at
the
home.
Keyboard. Yeah. So you're kind of a different proposition to this product, really. Okay. Another couple of questions going on. A question from Hatter, which is, how important is the chipset inside the tablet and upgrades to the performance of the iPad? So the chipset in the iPad Mini is largely the same as the iPad 2s, is that right?
Yes, so this has got the Apple A5 processor in it, which is, as I mentioned earlier, it's probably about two to sort of three generations older than, say, the one on the iPad 4, which has the Apple A6X processor.
You know your specs, I'll give
you that. I know. Well, I mean, I wouldn't say it's the basically Apple's claiming that the A6X processor is twice as fast as the one in the iPad 3. And the iPad 3 was around two to four times more faster than the iPad 2.
So that processor, just to clear up, that processor you're saying Apple claims is twice as fast, that's the one that lives inside the iPad 4, which is meant to be twice as fast as the iPad 3.
Yeah.
Now, the processor inside the iPad Mini is the same as the one in the iPad 2.
Yes.
So the processor in this, I mean, the iPad 2, when it was the newest Apple product, was sort of, you know, that was the tablet by which others were measured a couple of years back.
Yep.
And this is sort of holding true to that performance, isn't it? So this has been kind of even by Apple's own admission, superseded in performance by the full-size iPad 4 right now, don't you think? Okay.
Yeah, and actually, I think we're touching on a really good point here, because if you're thinking about buying an iPad Mini, I must confess, I would be very tempted to wait until perhaps early next year.
Do you think there's another one around the corner?
Well, I'm sure there is, and I imagine it will have maybe, it might have, say, the processor from the iPad 3, for example, which, although not a massive upgrade, will be a noticeable difference. And also, we haven't talked about 4G yet, and we talked a lot about that with the iPhone launch. So 4G is a new type of mobile network. It's five times faster than 3G, which means you can, say, stream an HD film with absolutely no buffering or anything like that at all. It's really, really cool. However, the iPad Mini and also the iPad 4 only support one network in the UK, which is EE, and will never support any other networks.
So let me get this right. Yeah. If you're someone who typically uses someone like Vodafone or O2, you couldn't buy this product and connect to a Vodafone or O2 4G network.
Yes, a 4G network. You can still use, if you buy a 3G version of this, you can still connect to the 3G networks that those networks have.
Okay.
However, you will never be able to get 4G. And that's, you know, we have this issue with the iPad 3 when Apple were wrapped around the knuckles quite correctly by trading standards for calling it the iPad with Wi-Fi plus 4G, when it would never actually work in the UK on 4G. So if you want 4G, for example, if you think, yes, I want to future-proof myself against this, then I would wait for the next version of this, which I would distinctly hope will support all the other networks as
well. Okay, so a little bit later on, when Vodafone, Orange, O2 are rolling out their 4G networks, it's going to require an entirely new Apple device, which will be able to tune into to those networks. So this one right now won't be able to do it for them, but it can connect to their 3G networks.
Yes.
Now, it's £269 for the Wi-Fi 16GB model. I'm guessing you've got to pay quite a bit more if you want to connect to 3G and 4G.
Yes, I must confess, you caught me out. I can't quite remember what the price for the sort of 4G.
I mean, as I recall,
normally about £100.
It's about £100 more, isn't it? I mean, if you stick to 16 gigabytes, you add on about £100 just for the cost of the device if you want to connect to 3G and 4G, and then you've got to pay sort of a monthly cost for your data allowance as well. Yeah. Now, the competitors, so you know, to pick up the Kindle Fire HD here, there's no 3G or 4G on this, is there?
No, there isn't. There is actually going to be a 3G version of the Nexus 7
coming up,
and that's only been recently announced. But there is no 3G version of this one.
Okay. Well, look, disregarding the fact that there aren't really much by way of 4G networks in the UK right now, if you were to go out and buy one of these mini tablets tomorrow, the Apple, the Kindle, the Google Nexus, would you go looking for 3G? I mean, is Wi-Fi enough?
Yeah, we've argued about this recently, I know. I would go for the 3G versions personally, because kind of for the same reason why I think buying a smaller one is better, because when you've got it with you and you can connect to the internet wherever you are, you just get a lot more out of it. I mean, one of the things I love to use, for example, is an app called Flipboard, which is a great app. It's kind of a magazine style app, and you can go into things, it has lots of different suppliers of content. This is a Harvard Business Review. And you know, the articles are kind of displayed in this nice magazine format like this, which is great. And you know, I can sit on the train and read this as I go, and it's really, really nice.
And with a 3G tablet, then you can keep on downloading magazines and new articles as you go.
Whereas, of course, if you've got a Wi-Fi one, you've got to download anything you want to look at before you go.
Right, well, yeah. We have disagreed on this in the past, but we've largely had that disagreement around 10-inch tablets. Because I've got to say, if I did own a 10-inch tablet, if I was going out to buy one, I wouldn't care less about 3G. Because I would probably treat this as something which I'll probably keep at home. I might take into work with me. If I need the internet, I can find a cafe or something.
And
the Wi-Fi will get me around.
And to be fair, you're probably with the majority there, Rich, because most research suggests that sort of 8 out of 10 to 9 out of 10 people generally leave their tablet at home. They are home devices. The most likely, I mean, the thing I normally see on the train, for example, is people watching video, for example.
That they might have downloaded at home before they went out.
Or reading books, for example.
But this is different, isn't it? I mean, this is meant to be taken out of the home. And funnily enough, I mean, I would take my phone with me, my smartphone, and just think, well, one of the great things about this is it's got 3G, I can connect to the internet anywhere. Would I actually want to go out and buy a product which is less functional in a way than the phone I've already got if this didn't have 3G, 4G? So, I mean, that's me. I mean, my mentality is going to be a bit different on that, because I actually wouldn't want a 3G 10-inch tablet. But I'd feel a bit sore about that if that couldn't connect to 3G the way that the phone already could.
Well, there is the option, if you've got a phone with 3G, to do something called tethering. And what that actually means is that you create a Wi-Fi network with your phone, which other devices that can connect to. So you could create a Wi-Fi network on your phone, your iPad or other tablet could connect to that and use the 3G connection of your phone. Now, some networks add extra charges.
If you try and do that,
something like that. So that's something worth considering, actually, is if you're going to buy a Wi-Fi tablet, could I tether it with my phone so that I could use the data on my phone? And, you know, this is an interesting area, I think, because I think in the future it would be really great if I could sign up to a network and have one contract where I can use the data on whatever device I have. Wouldn't that be lovely? Unfortunately, we're not there yet. But
not quite yet. Yeah. Andy, we've got time for just one more question coming through, and it's a very open-ended one. Here's 400 quid. Off you go shopping. You don't own a tablet. What would you go out and buy today?
With the danger of sounding partial, I would buy the iPad Mini.
You really like it that much more than everything else we've
seen. I would. I think when you're, particularly because of the App Store situation, we talked about this earlier, I think if you want to get the most out of the money you're spending on the product, you want to have the most choice when it comes to all the different apps available. And if that's the case, the iPad is still the king on that front. If you don't want to stretch the £269 of this one, out of the Kindle Fire HD and the Nexus 7, I'd definitely go for the Nexus 7.
Okay, so if you're looking for a cheaper alternative, you prefer the Nexus 7. Yeah. If you're looking for purely getting an Apple device, you yourself would prefer the Mini to the full size?
I think so. As I say, I would probably wait for the next version of this for the reasons we've already discussed. However, I really like this form factor. I think it's really, really nice. The keyboard is just about good enough for using day to day, and the fact that it's so much lighter and easy to carry is a real bonus.
Okay, all in all, sounds like you're a bit of a fan of this one.
Maybe a little bit.
I might not get one myself, but I'd happily borrow yours. Well, thank you very much for sending all of your questions in. And we're going to have to wrap it up for now. But please do check on at which.co.uk, where we have reviews of all the major tablets. You'll find reviews from Apple tablets, Android tablets, everything in between. And check on for all of our advice on which tablet you should buy. It's not just our opinions, it's Which Testing. And I hope it will help you choose the right tablet for you. Thanks once again for joining us, and we hope you found it useful.